So with the bacon, I'm just gonna let this kind of go on low heat for a while, and hopefully I don't burn it.
She's there to remind you.
So while we're doing that, I'm gonna throw a couple gloves on here. And then we're gonna make the, I'm gonna make the corn and black bean salsa so everybody has a chance to have a little snack while we're making the Mexican street corn and the chowder. Corn and black bean salsa, you can break this recipe down. My recipe that I have given you guys today requires like 2 cans of each of black beans and corn. If you can find chupeg corn in a grocery store,
what kind?
Chupeg, so it's really small kernels.
Oh, I love that stuff.
If you can find that in a grocery store, that's what I prefer to use.
Okay.
It's getting more increasingly harder to find it in a grocery store. So really any corn will work. You can also use frozen sweet corn for it as well. You could also take your own corn cobs, boil them off, and then shuck that. So take the corn right off the ears and use that too. That's what I do at home. Trying to do something easy that's store for everybody as well.
Mm-hmm.
To show you kind of a different way you can do it.
Just a quick question, is the chupeg always white? Is that the...
No, there is a yellow chupeg corn. It's just a smaller kernel. So it's about, it'd be about half the size of these kernels.
Okay. And it's so much better.
It is, it's very sweet.
Yeah, I like the chupeg
so
white,
good.
Yeah.
So with this, that means that we're gonna open the black beans and we'll open the black beans. We'll make sure that we drain both of them and rinse them both extremely well. And the black beans that you use, it doesn't really matter which ones you get from the store. They're all gonna pretty much do the same thing the recipe after the rinse. The different varieties of these and companies will put different liquids with them for storage purposes, but it's pretty much all the same actual bean.
So that's what the liquid stuff is, it's just a preservative.
Yeah, it's a preservative. Now you can cook, obviously you could use it in your salsa. It's gonna make your salsa like really sticky and kind of disgusting. Like I said, you can use any kind of corn you want. You can use corn on the cob for this. You can use frozen, you can use canned. Then you kind of just dump it all into the bowl together.
I'm sure it's still right up.
Yep, so with this then we add our red onion. Now with this amount, I'll add an entire red onion to this. For this, I like to dice it nice and small dice. Larger, you're gonna have more of that onion flavor when you take a bite. And then also inside this salsa, we also have cilantro.
Yeah.
It's hard to explain, but usually people that don't like cilantro don't like parsley either, because it does
parsley.
It does that same thing.
Oh.
A lot of times it does that same thing.
Right. Thank you.
So as a chef, we don't measure salt at all.
I know.
Just add it.
What
the right amount? Oh, that's enough.
So then, at this point, I'll kind of mix it up a little bit. Let that salt sit there for a second. Check the bacon. Bacon's doing good.
How's it look?
It's getting there. The fat starting to come
kind
out of that.
Yeah, washed out. Okay.
It smells really good. Yeah.
So I'll hit this with about 2 tablespoons of, 4 tablespoons. 2 tablespoons if you're only doing 1 can of each of olive oil. And then after the olive oil goes in there, I'm gonna add in a little bit of cumin. For that batch, probably about 3 tablespoons of cumin. Actually, we'll do 1.5 tablespoons of cumin. We'll adjust it after seasoning. That's 1.5. From there on, you can, my mom would eat it like this, because she doesn't like the cilantro. But I'm going to add on in tomatoes, because my mom's friend's recipe. They actually add tomatoes to the end of this. Now you can start to smell the salsa too.
Are you adding canned tomatoes or cherry tomatoes?
I'm actually going to use Roma tomatoes, and I'm going to dice them myself.
Okay.
I try to do this without the seeds in it as well. So then what we're going to do is we'll mix this up. Give you a little bit so that you can have some without the cilantro, and then I'll add the cilantro
to it.
Thank
you.
Finely chopped. Are you ready for some salsa?
Absolutely.
Oh, you can put it on it. Oh, there you go. Alright, so for the Mexican sweet corn, I'll make the mayonnaise and the sour cream mixture. So use 3 tablespoons of mayonnaise and 3 tablespoons of sour cream. We're just going to use a nice big bowl for this so that we can mix the corn in with it.
And how is this served? As a side dish?
So Mexican sweet corn can actually be a main course as well. Typically it would be served as a side dish for with some tortillas. A lot of times they like to put it inside a tortilla and eat it too, or just with a spoon, or it's on an ear of corn. Probably about a quarter cup of sour cream, and we'll do about the same amount of mayonnaise. I use real mayo. I know some people do prefer Miracle Whip over mayonnaise. I'm not one of them. About the same amount. Then we're going to add in 1 teaspoon of chili powder and a dash of cayenne. Chili powder. You can use dark or light chili powder. This is just dark, is just a little bit more toasted. And then just a small dash of cayenne. I don't know if anybody likes heat.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. She's telling me to keep going. Salt, a little bit of salt and pepper. And we have our, I'll add our queso fresco and more cilantro.
Yay.
So queso fresco comes in a wheel, but it crumbles up really easily. So this comes like a block that crumbles.
Okay.
So you literally just take it out of the package and you can crumble it. And you want to add about a quarter of a cup to this. So I will, that looks good. And then about a quarter cup of some fresh cilantro. So we'll do the same thing again. Now you'll notice this time I'm not gonna use all these thick stems like that, but the stems that are up by the leaves, perfectly fine. And I save all of my ends like this for stocks and soups.
Great idea.
No waste. Then we're just gonna mix this up here. And I believe our corn is ready to go out right out of the oven. So I'm actually going to broil this on high for about 2 minutes, and then we'll be really good here. So as you can see how it's kind of starting to get roasted here on the corner?
Mm-hmm. You want the whole thing?
I want the whole thing and a nice color on the whole thing.
Yeah.
So here's the Mexican corn mixture before we add any of the corn to it.
Okay.
Mayo? What else?
Mayo, sour cream, equal parts mayo and sour cream,
okay.
Cilantro,
mm-hmm.
Dark chili powder or light chili powder, mm-hmm. Doesn't matter, and a little bit of cumin.
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
okay.
That looks nice.
And then obviously the queso fresco.
Okay.
Now, typically speaking, if you do this with ears of corn on the top, you just do your mayo and sour cream mixture, roll the corn of cob right in that mixture, take that out, have your queso fresco out, roll that right in there, and then sprinkle it with your cayenne and your chili powder. And then eat it right off the cob.
Sticks to it,
yep.
And then the chili powder's on there.
Yeah, and then you go back to our baking here for a little bit. So our soup here is getting really close. At this point, I will dice up the regular onion, and we'll add that to our bacon so that our onion gets nice and translucent. It's called sweating the onion. So with this, I'm not too worried about how these onions look chopped. The typical thing with soup that you want to remember is when you hold a spoon, you want a little bit of each of the ingredients of the soup on that spoon. You want it all to be the same, roughly the same size and bite size. You get really big chunks of potato. I'll say that these are kind of big. Big chunks of potato and small chunks of onion. It's going to kind of turn people off.
Okay.
It's one of the things that you learn in the restaurant. You want stuff to all be that bite size. So like I said, it's not too concerned about getting all my chops the same size for the soup, because it sweats and the onion sweats, it kind of shrinks. So by sweating an onion, all I mean is you're sauteing that onion until it's translucent. You don't need to brown it, you don't want it to go too high, just so it's nice and translucent. So this will go right in with the bacon. So we're just getting this onion nice and translucent here. And I'm gonna do something a little off book for the recipe than the recipe I brought in today for the chowder. Typically what I do is I would then add my stocks, my potatoes to this chowder, bring that to a boil to cook the potatoes down, and then I take about a third of this and put it through a blender and blend it up, and that would thicken it.
Yeah.
And add it back in. And that's what thickens the soup. I'm actually going to use cornstarch today, which is another way you can do it. You could also use flour.
Yeah.
Cornstarch I prefer because it's a gluten-free option.
Right.
Sometimes when you use flour, you can get a little excessive, your soup's too thick, then all of a sudden you have to add more stuff to thin it down, and all of a sudden you have a pot like this that turns into a bigger pot. You go right from this, right into this hot. So this is going to melt this a little bit. A little bit of the mayo and sour cream is going to melt. You're going to put that in the fridge for about 30 seconds, let it coagulate a little bit, and then I'll serve it up.
Okay.
Oh,
interesting.
Kind of a little secret of the trade. All nice and...
Yeah.
Ooh, that smells really good. It's going to be good to go.
I'm good, thank you.
All right.
That was interesting.
With the soup now, the bacon is getting there. It's not quite where I'd like it to be. But it doesn't need to be that terribly good for this. I'm gonna turn it up before I add anything else. So this is how we have it right now. My onions are starting to become translucent. Mm-hmm.
This is very yummy.
It
really is. Very delicious.
I can see why you want to cook the corn kernels as much as you do.
Yeah, it gives it that nice crunch.
That
nice texture, that nice crunch. Otherwise it just would be kind of like slimy.
Slimy.
Yeah. And again, I prefer using frozen corn for that. There's a lot of fat in this bacon. So I'm probably going to drain a little bit of this, or scoop a little bit of this off, just so we don't have it.
Thank you. Do you usually save it then?
Yeah, I'd save it, and I like to cook my eggs in the morning in it. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Eggs, bacon fat in the morning.
I know you like that. I like food.
This bacon fat off, and I will use it to make the slurry with the cornstarch. Because at this point, what I'm going to do is I'm going to add one container of my stock. I never want to use all my stock at once, because if I use both of them at once and I make it too thick, now I have to use water to thin it. Water adds no flavor to your soup, it actually depletes your soup of flavor. So this, I'll add a little bit here. This is called deglazing the pan. Do this with red wine or any of that, or water, red wine, any of that. So what this does is it takes off all those brown bits that are on the bottom of the pan. That's all flavor. I'll add the rest of this stuff. I'm going to drain off my potatoes, and I will add my potatoes to this, and that has to cook for about 6 minutes. So those potatoes get nice and soft. Then I'll turn this up to high, let that go for about 6 minutes. Anybody knows how to make a slurry with cornstarch?
No, nope.
A little water.
So it's about half water, half cornstarch. Same mixture, half water, half cornstarch. Like I said, we got about 8 minutes for this to boil, and then we'll be good. We just gotta wait for the potatoes to get done. How was your first time here?
I'm enjoying it. This is what I love. So I'm totally having a great time.
Good.
Yeah, omelet for boil up with that. I'm gonna add both. I'm gonna add both bags of corn to it to make it really, really creamy. Hit it with a little bit of the cornstarch to thicken it, and then just check the seasoning, and we should be good to go on it.
When you said you put some of the soup in to thicken it in a blender,
yep.
When would you do that? What step?
As soon as the potatoes are done, I'd add the corn for about 3 minutes, and then I'd put it in the blender. Now, with that being said, you want to be extremely careful with your home blenders, because sometimes they can't handle the heat.
Right.
They'll explode, or they'll blow out the top, or they'll even melt your base. You don't want to do that.
Okay.
I don't want anybody to come in and tell me, oh, I burned my blender up.
Yeah.
Or, oh my gosh, I had to go to the hospital.
So take some aside.
You take a third of it aside, throw it in the freezer for 10 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
To get chilled, and then whip it up, and then mix it back in.
Okay, sounds good.
Then put your stuff back in. Mm-hmm. I do both heavy cream and milk in my soup, in my chowder soup. And I can already tell I'm going to have a little bit of a liquid issue, so I'm going to add a little bit more stock to it. We're going to bring it back to a boil for about 3 minutes. And after that 3 minute mark, I'll thicken it, and then we'll milk it and cream it out, and we'll be able to eat it. But like I said, we'll bring that to a boil. Shouldn't take too terribly long. We just added the corn to it. A little bit more stock. Any other questions? Any other favorite corn recipe? Oh. At this point, I'll also add a bay leaf. Now, you don't want to ever eat these. Bay leaves can make you extremely sick, but it's a very good spice. And I would strain out all my stuff and leave just the liquid. Thicken that and then put everything back in. At home, I don't do that when I make stuff at home.
Why do you do that at work?
I'm making about 12 gallons of it at a time.
Yeah.
It's just too big of a pot to be able to.
Oh, to put everything in.
Because literally some of her pots, I'm literally like this with a whisk.
Oh.
So with all that stuff in there, I just can't mix it properly.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I don't like having, like my cream, you'll notice I'll turn this down here as it starts to get thicker. I don't like my cream soups because if you leave it on big pots like that, you have to, after you cream everything out, you should technically bring it back to a boil. I can't do that with the soups at work because the bottom will burn.
Oh, sure.
And if a cream soup burns, the entire batch is ruined.
It's going to give the flavor to all of it.
So I actually need a touch more cornstarch here, and then we'll be good to go. And I'm going to add a touch of milk here, just a little touch.
We've all done that, yeah.
Oh, I was so sad.
Especially since we live here.
I'm going to add this entire cream to it.
What's
Bio stew. So this is a little bit of thyme, just a nice seasoning for a nice corn chowder soup. We are almost there. So at this point, another reason why I like using cornstarch is after you cream a soup, you can't roux it. Roux is butter and flour mixture.
Right.
Thickener. Cornstarch, you can actually thicken this again after you cream it. It won't break it. Whereas the roux will actually break it. All right, so our chowder here is good to go. How is it?
Excellent.
You're coming.
Thank you.
What should we do next month?